So earlier this morning, there's a presentation that talked about some of the unseen connections between soil microbes and plants. And I'm going to kind of continue that, but I'm going to have more talk about the soil microbes that live within plant tissues. But before I do, I just want to talk a little bit about why hemlock is an important species in Great Smoky Mountains National Park, as well as throughout the eastern U.S. So they're important for a few different reasons. One is that they have a structurally complex canopy. As they grow older, they don't tend to lose some of their lower limbs, and so they have this sort of vertically stratified habitat for many animal species and other organisms. They also grow next to stream banks. They like these areas that are ephemerally inundated with water, and so they can stabilize the stream banks, but then also shading these streams as well to keep temperatures cool and keep streams healthy. And another way that they keep streams healthy is that they have relatively low nutrient, or their needles are relatively low in nutrients, so this prevents sort of downstream eutrophication in streams. However, these hemlock forests, especially in Great Smoky Mountains National Park, and then but more broadly throughout the eastern U.S., are under threat. And one of the reasons for this is this invasive insect, the hemlock woolly adelgid, which was introduced in the 1940s that kind of came across from Asia with these Asian ornamental hemlocks. And what it does is it lays eggs sort of at the intersection of the needles and the branch, where then it then feeds at that intersection, which prevents nutrient flow through the needles and causes the needles to discolor and defoliate. And you can see that it's pretty substantial, the impact on these hemlock environments. You see a lot of dead trees here from that. And as I mentioned before, it's seen here in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park, but then it spread northward and continuing to spread northward due to climate change, because it has these, there are more generations of hemlock woolly adelgid determination. It was first detected in 2002 in Great Smoky Mountains National Park. And another thing to mention is that where it is native in Asia, it doesn't necessarily cause hemlock death in those Asian contexts. But then also, when some of these Asian hemlock species are brought over here, it still doesn't cause death of those hemlocks. So there seems to be some sort of bottom-up reason for that. And so, there have been a couple of different ways that we've tried to control for hemlock woolly adelgid, one of them being chemical spraying. And while that is effective, it's not necessarily sustainable. We can't really spray the entire forest. Other ways that we've tried to do this is introduce these predators of the hemlock woolly adelgid that are native to its range. However, they don't really establish here. And so far, the success has been somewhat limited. One area that hasn't been looked at as much is looking at the microbiome of the hemlock. So we know that in human microbiomes, that depending on the microbes that live inside your gut, can really impact how susceptible you are to disease. And so we're interested then, is there, can the hemlock microbiome be utilized in a way to prevent hemlock woolly adelgid death? And there's reason to think that it can. So I'm presenting here some work from another plant context. This is a brassica or a mustard. And in the left-hand panel here is a ordination of the community. And so we've seen a couple of these of the rhizosphere microbial community. We've seen a couple of these ordinations today, but the main thing to take away is that points that are closer together are more similar in their community composition. Points that are further apart are more dissimilar. So they had this treatment where they disrupted the microbiome, and so you can see then that the microbiome is much different in the disrupted sites compared to these intact microbiomes. And this is in the rhizosphere too. And this caused the plant to have a different metabolic profile. So their the citrate cycle is increasing with the disruption, and different things are going on with the plant. And ultimately, this results in less leaf damage or more leaf damage when you have a disrupted microbiome in the rhizosphere. And so we want to see is, can we find some similar sort of pattern with hemlock and with the hemlock woolly adelgid? And so previous work has looked at the, in my lab, has worked at the, looked at the microbiome of different hemlock species, some of which are resistant, some of these Asian hemlocks that are resistant to hemlock woolly adelgid, even here in the eastern US, and some that are more susceptible, including canadensis, which is our native species, but then siboldii is a non-native hemlock, but is still susceptible over here. And so you can see that both the archaeal and bacterial community, as well as the fungal community, sort of have these different microbiomes by different species. And so perhaps there's, maybe there is a microbiome or association with hemlock woolly adelgid. However, this previous work didn't really see any sort of, like, even in the susceptible hemlocks, there wasn't necessarily an association with hemlock woolly adelgid infestation. However, this previous study had some limitations. First of all, it had pretty low replication, and also only studied the branch microbiome. And so we know that there are different microbiomes throughout the tree, just like humans have different skin microbiome compared to gut microbiome compared to lung microbiome. There are different microbiomes in the hemlock, needle versus branch versus fruit, rhizosphere, and it's unclear whether they would all respond in the same way. And so we tried to increase the scope and robustness of this study by, like I said, increasing replication to kind of increase our power of detection, but then also looking at these different plant-associated habitats or niches. I kind of use those two words interchangeably. And so our overall goal here is to understand then the relationships between the hemlock microbiome and hemlock woolly adelgid infestation. So we had a couple of hypotheses. One is that, as with other plants, we have hypothesized that plant-associated habitats, so these different niches, will harbor these distinct microbiomes. And then certain taxa will respond positively and negatively to hemlock woolly adelgid. Specifically, we think that plant pathogens might increase with hemlock woolly adelgid because the plant defense is somewhat compromised from this disturbance, and that the largest changes will occur in these habitats nearest to the infection site, so in these above ground habitats. And then these differences in the microbiome will be partially explained by plant and soil chemistry. Because, like I said before, the hemlock woolly adelgid disrupts nutrient flow throughout the plant. And so we didn't, unlike most of the presentations today, we did not conduct this in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park because we wanted to look at a common garden. We took a common garden approach where we planted these different hemlock species all in the same area because we know that the soil characteristics can influence the plant microbiome. And so we conducted this at NC State's Horticultural Research Center outside of Asheville. And we have this little plot of hemlocks here. Oh, and forgot to mention, so some of these trees had hemlock infestation and some of them did not, growing right next to each other, which is sort of amazing that not all of them were infested with hemlock. And so looking at the difference in the microbiome between those that have high infestation and low infestation at the same location. And so here I'm presenting the archaea and bacteria microbiome in the two above ground plant tissues, so the needle and the branch. And again, we have these multivariate ordinations, whereas plants that are more closely together are more similar in their community composition. Plants that are further apart are more dissimilar. And can't really read these here, but there's a significant effect of the hemlock woolly adelgid infestation in both the needle and the branch. However, it only explains 4 to 6% of the overall variation, so it's a really modest effect. As well, there's also a host effect. So these two different hemlock species have a different microbiome. And in the below ground, we don't see as much of a hemlock-related adelgid effect on the microbiome here. In roots, we see an interaction, whereas there is a host effect only in the low infestation. And then in the rhizosphere, we don't even see a host effect. And again, this is for the archaea and bacteria. Now looking at the fungal microbiomes in the above ground plant tissues, we only see a hemlock woolly adelgid effect in the needle. Again, it explains about 5% of the variation in the community. But as we saw before, we have this relatively stronger host species effect, explaining 15 to 20% of the above ground microbiome. And similar to what we saw for, similar to what we saw with the archaea and bacteria, the fungal root microbiome is only explained by root, or sorry, by the host species, and the rhizosphere is pretty consistent among host species and the hemlock-related adelgid infestation. We were also interested in specific microbial guilds. One that's, I think, important to many people here are mycorrhizae, and so, while hemlock primarily associate with ectomycorrhizal fungi, we also saw that there was a decent amount of association with arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi. And while we didn't see any significant trends here, we do see sort of, you know, there's a lot of variation in the data here, but we do see some sort of trending towards some sort of significance here, where we see a decrease in the arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi here. And I think more and more evidence is coming out that Pinaceae, which hemlock are a part of, actually do associate with both types of mycorrhizae. And so if we do see hemlock woolly adelgid impacting the relative dominance of these two mycorrhizal types, we could see some ecosystem level effects, because they do affect the ecosystem in different ways in terms of carbon storage and nutrient cycling. And then, in contrast with our hypothesis, we didn't see a hemlock woolly adelgid effect on plant pathogens, at least the relative abundance. I have data that I'm not going to present today looking at specific fungal pathogens, and there are some differences where hemlock woolly adelgid has increased some pathogens, suggesting that there might be some sort of compound disturbance happening here. But if you're interested in that, we can talk after. And so we were also interested in trying to explain the variation in the hemlock microbiome based on these plant and soil chemical variables. And for the most part, we couldn't really explain the variation in this. So only in three sort of plant tissues and plant tissue sort of amplicon combinations. And by amplicon, like amplicons, I mean 16S explaining bacteria and archaea, and ITS explaining fungi. So really only in the needle and root archaea and bacteria microbiomes, and in the branch ITS or fungi microbiome, we see correlation between these environmental variables and the community composition. Interestingly though, the ratio of carbon to nitrogen in the branch and in the root and in the branch for ITS explained a large, or was a significant predictor of the microbiome, which is sort of along the lines of our hypothesis where changes in the chemical characteristics can impact the microbiome. So taken together, it's still pretty early in determining what the effects are or what the directionality is in terms of the hemlock microbiome and hemlock woolly adelgid. Right now we have, these are really more observational, and we need to validate this experimentally. We could investigate some of these fungal pathogens that, I haven't shown today as sort of a starting point for that. And then if we do see difference, if we kind of further, if we go a little further along with our study here, or with our findings here, you know, we do see differences in the microbiome with hemlock woolly adelgid, and this could have some higher, some consequences for higher trophic levels. And so with that, acknowledge some of our funding sources and a great group of people who got to sample, and I will take any questions. Thanks. Oh, sorry. Yes, Jessica.
Hi. I'm curious about dispersal. Do you know if the adelgid can disperse the microbiome from one tree to another?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I mean, so I don't know. There is some work looking at the hemlock woolly adelgid microbiome, so the microbiome of the insect. So that could be one way we could sort of track that. That work hasn't been published yet, but I know some people at UT are working on that. Talking about dispersal, branches in this study plot are overlapping, and you'll see a branch totally inundated with, or totally infested with the hemlock woolly adelgid, and one right next to it that's not. So at least in terms of hemlock woolly adelgid, there doesn't seem to be, in our study site, a whole lot of a dispersal effect. Which is really interesting, you know, makes you think that there's something going on with either plant genetics or, like I said, the microbiome that could be determining whether it becomes infested or not. Thanks.